Okay, in this video, we are going to look at domain and range, and we are going to see how those definitions of domain and range can apply in situations where we have word problems. So let's start with the first one. In this first question, it says you have a 10-question test. Your teacher decided to curve your grade so everyone receives a 15-point bonus. If your score is a function of the number, we've got a little typo right there, a function of the number of questions you get correct, find the domain and range, and just as a little note, we're going to assume there's no partial credit. So a good thing to do really in any situation where you're dealing with a function is we want to start by defining our variables. So it looks like the two things that we're comparing in this situation are the number of questions correct and your score, okay? So we got to ask ourselves, one of those is going to be independent variable and one of those is going to be the dependent variable. So our independent variable in this situation is going to be the number of questions that you get correct. And our dependent variable, what depends on the number you get correct, is your score, okay? And the reason this is important to know is because the entire group of our independent variable, or our x's, we refer to that as our domain. So we can't even start to talk about what our domain is until we know what our variables represent. Our dependent variable of score, this is important to know because that entire group of our dependent values, typically what we use is y for that. We refer to that group as our range. Now that we know those, let's start to write ourselves a function. So we know that our score is going to be equal to, let's see, if there's 10 questions, let's see, our independent variable is x, and if there's 10 questions, that means every question is worth 10 points. So, for example, if you got one question right, you'd have a 10, two questions right would be a 20, so on and so forth. What I have to wrap into this, though, is that 15-point bonus that everyone got. So I've got to wrap in that 15-point bonus, okay? So this is going to be our function. 10 times the number of questions you get correct plus 15 for that 15-point bonus. Now, let's go ahead and discuss our domain, okay? Our domain is going to be, let's see, it's going to be basically all the number of questions that you could get correct. So if I start here, like we could get zero questions correct, or I could get one question correct, two questions correct, and that really goes all the way up to 10 questions correct. It's a 10-question quiz. So we don't really have to do any math to figure this out. We just know that our domain is going to be some number in here. Now, note that it's important. I didn't write this with inequality or interval notation. And the reason I did not do this is because this inequality notation implies a continuous function, meaning I could have 1.3 questions correct, or I could have 7.92 questions correct. In this situation, you're either getting a whole number value of questions correct. It's going to be one of these, so we write it in this notation versus using an inequality or an interval. Now, if that's our domain, we can now look at our range. Now, there's two ways that we can figure out our range. One is I can take each of these domain values, and I could substitute into my function and work it out, and I would get the corresponding range value. And I could just do that for each of the 10 values in my domain. Or 11 values, I guess, if you count zero. But, so let's do it for the first one. If I put in a zero into my function, that would be 10 times zero plus 15. So that means that our first range value would be 15. And then I could put a one into my function. 10 times one is 10, plus 15 would be 25. And then you see that our points are going to go up by 10 every time. And our maximum score isn't going to be a 100. It said that there was a 15-point bonus for that curve, so your maximum score would be a 115. So the first way of finding that range is just take each of those domain values and substitute them into your function. The other way is just like read the problem and understand what it's saying. For example, we know there's a 15-point bonus. That means the minimum grade you can get is a 15. Then I know every question is giving me 10 more points. I don't have to use a function to figure that out. And just kind of reason through it and realize that your maximum is 115. So to kind of summarize, here's your domain and your range. It's important that we write them like this with these commas because this is what we call a discrete relationship. It's discrete. It's not continuous. Our graph in this case would be like a series of dots for each of your corresponding, for your grades as they increase as a function of the questions correct, okay? I know it's kind of sloppy, but this is what your graph would look like. Now let's go ahead and look at the next one. A concert venue holds 50 people. Each ticket costs $15. And a function can be written that describes the total income of the venue as a function of the number of tickets sold. Find the domain and the range. Now, let's see. Our first thing that we need to do, once again, is let's identify our variables. I'll try to be consistent with my colors. What did I use, red last time for this? Our independent variable and our dependent variable. Well, what depends on what? It looks like you've got total income is one variable and the number of tickets sold is the other variable. Well, our independent variable is going to be that number of tickets sold. And our dependent variable would be like the revenue or the income or the amount of money made. But we're basically talking about, we're basically talking about money here. And this is important, once again, because all of the possible number of tickets sold, we refer to that group of values as our domain. And all of the revenue values, we refer to that as our range. Now, let's write ourselves a little function. We know that if y is our revenue right here, our revenue is going to be the number of tickets times 15, because there is $15 per ticket. So we can come over here and we can start to write our domain. The minimum number of tickets they could sell would be 0, and they could sell 1, they could sell 2, and that number is going to top out at 50. And the reason I got 50 is because it says the venue holds 50 people. Hopefully they're not going to sell more than 50 tickets. Now for our range, the minimum amount they could make, if I were to take my 0 and substitute in my function, 0 times 15, well, it's kind of common sense, is $0. Then if they sold one ticket to this concert, then they would make $15. And I can keep taking these domain values and substitute them into our function to find the range values. The highest amount of money they could make would be if they sold out, if this last value of our domain was multiplied by 15. So if we took 50 and multiplied it by 15, that would be $750. So once again, you got your domain and your range. This is another example of a discrete relationship. Notice, I did not write my domain or my range with inequality notation. Okay? Because that inequality notation implies that our x can take any value between 0 and 50, including little decimals. And we know here we don't have decimals. You can't sell 1.5 tickets. So this is how we want to write our domain and our range. Okay, in this last example, let's see, we've got, it says when driving for Uber, there's a base fare, which is a flat fee you're charged at the beginning of the ride. Suppose the, or I guess, well, I should say when riding for Uber, but it says suppose the base fee is $2 and you're charged 40 cents per mile. The amount charged is a function of the total number of miles driven. So it's telling us that the amount charged is a function of the number of miles driven, okay? So when it's written like that, that means that the amount charged depends on the miles driven. And remember, that's super important in these situations because the group, that entire set of the amounts that we could be charged, we call that our range. And that total set of the number of miles that we could drive, we call that our domain. Now, if we're to write this function that's described here, we know that the amount charged is going to be equal to 40 cents per mile, or 40 cents times x, but we got to add in that base fee as well. If there's ever a base fee, that acts like our y-intercept over here. Now, for our domain, okay? Our domain, as we mentioned, is all the possible miles. So we could start at 0. I don't know if it makes a whole lot of sense in this situation. But it could go up to, let's see, you go 1 mile, 2 mile. It could go all the way up to 10 miles because they tell you for up to 10 miles in this problem. Now, here's the situation. When we write our domain like this, it's implying that I can go 0 miles, or I can go 1 mile, or I can go 2 miles. But it doesn't leave us any wiggle room for in between. Like, what about if I want to go 1.5 miles or 1.75 miles? Well, that's because this function is what we call continuous. And so we want to write our domain a little bit differently. I want to write it like this. And this inequality notation implies that x can take values anywhere between 0 and 10. We'll learn later about another notation here called interval notation. But for now, just know that in this case, I want to include the inequalities to describe my domain because our number of miles driven isn't going to always be a whole number. Okay, it can be little fractions and decimals. And therefore, our range is really going to be the same way. Okay, our minimum y value, if you weren't sure what our minimum amount charge would be, you can take 0, substitute into your function, and work it out. But we remember that base fee is $2. So that's the minimum amount we can get charged. To find out the maximum amount we can get charged, we can take 10 and substitute into our function. 40 cents times 10 would be $4. And then I add the 2, and that would be $6. Okay? So for this situation, the most you're going to pay is $6. Okay? Now, the issue with this problem is I just made up all these numbers. I'm fairly certain if you wanted to go 10 miles, your Uber charge would be much greater than $6. But cut me some slack, I just made this up. But here's the main idea with this problem. This problem is what we call continuous, okay? We have continuous data. When we're talking about a distance, that's gonna be continuous. Our range, since we're talking about money, is gonna be continuous because I don't have to have whole numbers of dollars. If you wanted to be nitpicky, I mean, I guess you could say that your range might be discrete because it has to be a number of cents, like you can't have 32.7 cents, but for all intents and purposes, when you're talking about money, you're most likely going to have it as continuous as we have it here. But let me summarize this video real quick. When you have a word problem, start by identifying your independent and dependent variables. Once you know what those are, you know that group of independent variables is called your domain. And then we can kind of reason through what it is. And then that group of dependent values is going to be your range. And we can reason through that what that is. And then our domain and range kind of make sense in terms of the problems that we're given.